Everyone, this is Good Health Naturally, and we are continuing our series on how to live with your back. If you have a bad back, there are ways to rehabilitate your back. If you have a good back, there are ways to prevent having problems and getting a bad back. Today, my guest is a colleague in a natural approach to health, a PhD in nutrition, a man from Staten Island who practices right here on Staten Island, Dr. Fred Bishy. Dr. Bishy, welcome. I'm glad you're here today. And we'll talk about a biochemical approach or a nutritional approach to managing musculoskeletal pain.
Okay, thank you very much, Dr. Dolan. I'm very happy to be here. I always look forward to coming down to share some of the things I could help people with Staten Island with them. It's very, very important when a person has a problem with lower back or any kind of inflammatory disease, even from a trauma, it's important that a person try to make their system alkaline. And you can do that by the foods that you eat. First, I'd like to touch on the foods that make your system acid. When I say the foods that make your system acid, that's the ash that's left over from the metabolism of the food. Many people think if they eat an orange, that the orange is acid forming. It's really alkaline. Citrus is really alkaline. So if a person had an injury, if they ate oranges, that would aid in making their system alkaline. The foods that lead to an acid system are basically the protein foods, meat, junk foods, the foods that we buy in, you know, fast foods. Most all of them are acid forming. Not only for the food content itself, but some of the additives that are in the food. Some of the fast foods, they're high in fat and high in protein. They have a lot of salt added to them. That alone, that type of a meal is definitely going to exacerbate pain. If you have a trauma or if you have a bad back and there's some inflammation there, it increases the inflammation. Alkaline forming foods, they reduce inflammation. Intercellular pressures, retention of fluid. If you're eating a fast food hamburger and it's got a lot of sodium on it, it's definitely going to increase your pain. Diet sodas that are high in phosphoric acid, the sodium table salt, sodium chloride, a food like pizza, that's another food that would make your system acid. Sometimes the combination of foods, if you're eating too many foods in one meal, it's going to put a burden on your digestive process, and it's going to lead to an acid ash, and it's definitely going to cause you pain. It's very easy for a person to experience this if they're having a problem. The results are very, very quick. If they reduce the protein foods, the fat foods, the condiments, like black pepper, salt, some of the other condiments which are inflammatory, anything that's inflammatory is going to increase pain. It's going to increase the retention of fluid because the acid-forming foods, if they're in solutions, especially in the lymph cells, the body...
Make you
hold the water. Anything, whenever you're holding water, as you know, you're going to have more pain. If you have a knee injury and your knee swells up, part of the reason, besides the trauma to whatever, to the joint, to the tendons, or to the ligaments, is definitely going to come that you're retaining more fluid. That's why when we drain, we reduce the fluid content, we automatically see some kind of relief.
Well, one of the simple recommendations I give my patients is to avoid salt, whether it's a sprained ankle, knee, back. Salt is almost like a magic bullet. Medicine's been looking for magic bullets. Salt is a magic bullet. It goes to the spot where you're injured, and it makes you blow right up.
Absolutely.
And it's a very simple recommendation not to salt your food. And if you can, avoid salty food, and that way you don't hold water and don't put fluid into the tissue. And people don't realize that even after the first few days, if the swelling goes down, the visible swelling, there's still fluid left in those tissues.
Oh, absolutely.
even 2 months later. So salt is one simple thing I tell them to stay away from. What acidic foods would you say people definitely, absolutely have to stay away from?
When they have an injury?
Yes.
Well, unfortunately, the best thing to do is to stick to the simple, basic foods. Because there are so many foods that are acid-forming, to go through them all, most people would forget. Like all the condiments, diet sodas, all the flesh foods are acid-forming.
Fish, chicken too?
Fish, chicken, definitely.
Or acid forming.
Yes, some of the grains, like rice is acid forming, brown rice is slightly acid forming. The only two grains that are not acid forming are millet and buckwheat. They're alkaline. Potatoes, all the tubers, all the root vegetables, they're alkaline. Wheat is highly acid forming. If you got an injury, you want to feel pain, eat a lot of pasta, eat a lot of bread.
Eat a lot of whole wheat bread.
Eat a lot of whole
wheat. That'll bring
the pain. Even whole
on.
Wheat, yes. Even whether it's whole wheat or it's made from white flour, you're definitely gonna exacerbate pain.
What's the chemistry of why if you're acidic, why do you feel more pain? Do you produce more pain or you just become more sensitive to the pain?
Well, both. You actually see, the acid-forming foods are inflammatory. Your body has to secrete more fluid, or you need more fluid. That's why when you eat a lot of pasta, a lot of wheat, a lot of acid-forming foods, you have more thirst. When eating alkaline foods, basically the plant foods like fruits and vegetables, most people say that they're never thirsty when eating a lot of, when their system is alkaline, which is true. The more acid-forming your diet is, the more water you should be drinking in between meals, because water's a transport medium. It carries out metabolic waste and some of the waste from your diet.
Are tomatoes or tomato sauce, are they acidic or alkaline producing?
Tomatoes are alkaline, but when you cook tomatoes, right. And the longer you cook the tomatoes, the more acid forming it becomes. Because the longer you cook it, it's like some people make tomato sauce. You hear about people making tomato sauce on Sundays and they cook it all day.
Right.
And they make a meat sauce. Well, that's almost like drinking an acid as far as I'm concerned.
Right.
With all the people I work with I work with a lot of people that have, that are being treated by a chiropractor or a medical doctor for inflammatory disease, and 90% of the time I see dramatic results very, very quickly. So they're amazed. They don't realize how profound the effects of an alkaline diet could really be, even with allergies. Primary type food allergy, it's a double-edged sword.
An allergy is an inflammatory process as
Definitely.
Well.
Definitely. So if you have an injury and you have a primary type food allergy, that's a double-header as far as pain is concerned. And the common allergens are, wheat, dairy. Dairy is neutral. It's neither acid or alkaline. But if you're eating pizza and you have the whole wheat or the wheat crust,
right.
And then you have the tomato sauce, and then you have the dairy products. If you have a problem with dairy products, and the lactose intolerance is not the only problem with dairy products with some people. It's the casein. The casein leads, it's very, very thick and it's very, very mucus forming, even with people that don't have a problem with lactose. So when you have something, when the body has to secrete mucus, you're gonna have more pain. There's gonna be more intercellular pressure, more fluid retention in the tissue, so this is a factor too.
Obviously, if I'm eating the right diet before I get injured, it'll help me heal faster.
Absolutely.
But if I get injured and I find out about this, about nutritionally managing my pain, how long does it take the acids in my system to get out of my system if I stop today and I eat right for the next several days or the next several weeks to help my injury heal or to help me feel less pain?
Well, it depends upon the nature of the injury, but a good deal of the time, the results are very, very dramatic. I just have a professional athlete that's a client of mine. I do a lot of telephone work. He plays with the Lakers. He's just changing to Orlando Magic. He's been on a very healthy eating regimen for a number of years. He's 35 years old. I just spoke to him today over the phone. He told me he's playing better than he's ever played in his whole life. What's against him is his age now, to be picked up by another team because they can pick up a younger fella. But the amazing thing that he told me is that his injuries are down so much before, when he was eating a high-protein type of diet, he says that he had lots of injuries. He suffered many injuries. Now he suffers probably 50% less injuries, plus the downtime, which is very, very important for a professional athlete. He says he recovers so much quicker. It's unbelievable.
So if you have an alkaline-forming diet, you're actually less prone to injury, too.
Yes. Less muscle pulls, less tears, the muscles are more elastic, more pliable, less pulls. What he does, which I recommend for when a person has an injury, I recommend that they use liquid fruits and vegetables because they're very powerful alkalizers. They actually neutralize a lot of the acid in the system. So a quicker way to do that is to have them drink lots of juices, and there's an amazing change immediately. I had another fellow that's a professional athlete who was involved in an automobile accident. He had plastic surgery on his face, and he had a hand injury, and he expected to be on painkillers for a long time. As soon as he came out of the hospital, he switched to an alkaline type of diet. Very, very impressive recovery. He's totally amazed by what
happened. Have you found medicines to be particularly acidic or alkaline forming in the body?
Well, my experience has shown me that most medications, they're acid forming.
So even if you take a painkiller, it sort of works against itself?
Well, to that degree, yes, but it, you know, symptomatically it works in another way. What you're dealing with that type of a thing, it's natural. You're not dealing with the cause unless you're increasing the circulation, using something to increase blood circulation for healing. But what you're doing, you're working pharmacologically. You're just shutting down pain symptomatically there. It's like some of the anti-inflammatory drugs, like the steroids. They don't really deal with, they just reduce the inflammation so you have less pain. But there are some profound side effects there. You know, most doctors use them very carefully for that reason.
Well, we've talked about the inflammatory process with injuries and allergies. How about colds? If your system is acidic or alkaline, are you more prone to colds, flus, viruses? I've heard
well,
that in the acidic system.
Well, that's a touchy matter. If your system is acid, you're more prone to infection. Now, many people think that if you make the system acid, that there'll be less bacteria proliferation.
An acid system is less bacteria.
If the environment gets acid enough, the bacteria...
But bacteria usually isn't our problem.
Usually,
it's very rare. If a bacteria takes over your body, you're in bad shape.
Bacteria are very
opportunistic.
Correct. What we have to look at is the human body is a very sophisticated biological machine. As you know, it has remedial capabilities. If we know how to utilize those remedial capabilities to the utmost, what we can accomplish is amazing. That I believe the medicine of the future, is part of it is how to utilize the remedial capabilities of the body to the utmost. Healing time would be so much quicker. I also believe that genetic engineering is also something that's going to be another form of dealing with certain ailments of the future. If we put everything together, if we put chiropractic together with medicine, nutrition, if we understand that the human body, what we leave out is actually more important than what we include. That's the difficult thing for people to accept and to understand. Many people just in recent times, people are starting to look at this healing in a different light. We always try to force healing upon the human body by a few separate entities, giving a person maybe a few foods that were supposed to be healthy and healing. It really doesn't work that way. What really heals a person is the human body. If we focus on the human body, as I said before, as a very sophisticated biological machine, has healing capabilities. Just like when you have a cut, we have the ability to heal.
It heals on its own.
It heals on its own.
Well, as long as you're healthy to begin with, it heals on its own.
That's true. But we can also improve by leaving out the basic causes of disease. And it's controversial now what they really are. I mean, 10 years ago, some of the things that were sent 10 years ago were unacceptable, now are getting to be mainstream.
How about vitamins? Are any vitamins in particular acid-forming or alkaline-forming, or are they neutral vitamins and minerals?
Well, anything that's been synthesized in a laboratory is usually acid-forming.
Okay, would that be a synthetic vitamin? Would be acid-forming?
Well, yes, they're acid-forming. Synthetic vitamins are usually acid-forming.
How about a natural vitamin?
Well,
vitamin derived from a natural source.
We have to remember they're all synthesized in a laboratory. So they're from a natural source, but they're not totally natural like some people would like us to believe. Now, they are healing. Like if you take vitamins, if you had a tooth extracted and you took large doses of vitamin C, you would see a tremendous difference. Like I just had a person yesterday that had a tooth extracted.
Well, vitamin C would help the healing.
It would also help the pain. It helps reduce pain dramatically.
But vitamin C is
acid forming. But it'd be working pharmacologically.
Okay.
See, it's actually in megadoses. It's actually working. We have to keep in mind that vitamins and minerals are chemicals that the body uses as essential nutrients. When you take them in megadoses, the effect is really pharmacological. Beyond a certain point, they're not working as nutrients. Like vitamin C, maybe beyond 150 milligrams or 200 milligrams of vitamin C, the body secretes an enzyme, vitamin C oxidase, where vitamin C is not being utilized as a nutrient as far as on a cellular level. But it will enable us to heal when you take them in megadoses because it's stimulating the endocrine secretions. So it does promote healing.
Another thing that I've read about and heard about causing problems in the body is just drinking while you're eating, drinking anything. Digestion system-wise, what do you think about that?
Well, I think it's, you're diluting your hydrochloric acid and pepsin, you're weakening the effect there. Many people don't believe that, but all you have to do is try it. If you have problems with your digestion, you have flatulence,
if you drink when you eat.
Simplify your diet and don't drink water when you're eating. Eat less. So many people eat 10, 15, maybe even 18, 20 foods in one meal. I mean, you're putting a burden on your digestive process there. If you simplify your diet, if you have a hearty appetite, eat more of, say, 5 or 6 foods, you'll find you'll have less flatulence. You'll have more energy because it's a direct relationship to how hard your stomach has to work to metabolize food. The average person expends about 70% of their energy on food metabolism. If you only expend 20% of your energy on digesting, you're going to have 50% more energy right off for kinetic energy to do whatever you have to do.
How long before or after my meal, how long should I drink something?
Well, I think it would be best to wait approximately, don't drink for approximately a half hour before a meal and to wait at least an hour after a meal. When you're drinking fluids with your meal, you're just accelerating the whole process. Digestion begins in your mouth.
Right.
So if you're drinking water, you're flushing everything down, you're rushing everything through.
And you're diluting
the
enzymes that break, that digest the food.
Working against you two different ways there.
Well, let's recap again the foods that we should avoid. The American diet.
Well,
right? Fast foods, pizza.
All the fast foods. I mean, you go into, if you're having a hamburger with French fries.
You're going to hurt worse with that sprained ankle or that low back pain.
My recommendation is a very simple thing. There's no way it can harm you. I recommend that people try it. It's dramatic, and the effects are very, very quick.
Stay away from salt, pepper, or other condiments.
Oh, absolutely. If you're
they're
in pain.
They're all acidic for me.
Right. They're gonna increase the amount of pain you're feeling.
Is fiber acid-forming or alkaline-forming, or is that neutral
fiber?
Well,
it's undigestible cellulose. That will help you with pain because it expedites the transit time of your food. If you are eating, say you are going to have a hamburger, the best thing to do is have a big salad with it. Plus, you can also use the alkaline foods as if they were an antidote. Say if you can eat a lot of acid-forming foods, make sure that you're eating a lot of alkaline foods because it creates balance there. It'll help you. It's like taking the antidote before you take the quote-unquote the poison. If you had, say you had a vegetable juice extractor, if you had took a glass of vegetable juice and had a big salad, and then you had a plate of pasta, the effects of inflammation and the acid-forming effect of the pasta will nowhere near be as much as if you didn't, say you just had 2 bowls of pasta. Then if you had meatballs with it, you didn't have no salad and no juice, even if you didn't have the juice, and you just had a big salad, you had some steamed vegetables, you put some broccoli in your pasta, a very good chance you're not going to feel as much pain as you did the other way.
Well, you just said brings up another question to me. Calories. If I'm in pain, low back pain or ankle pain, whatever, mm-hmm. shoulder pain, right. Should I increase my caloric intake or decrease my caloric intake, which will help me get over it better?
Decrease it. Definitely don't overeat. Eat a substantial amount of food. Because if you overeat, if you eat a lot of food.
Because I might be, if I'm an athlete, maybe I am upset over my injury. Some people turn to eating and they eat more, when they're depressed or upset.
That's a mistake, because then you're expending more energy for digestion.
And not for repair.
Not for repair.
Okay, so decrease
the human,
your calorie.
The human body is an energy system. And the simpler we make how we ingest our food, the more energy we're going to have. You can actually be eating a diet that's lower in calories, which will provide more energy, whether for exercise or for healing, if you're eating the right foods than if a person was eating a higher calorie diet. If you're eating, say you're eating a pork roast and potatoes, eat a lot of pork and a lot of potatoes, you're not going to have much energy left over for kinetic energy there.
Right.
Because it's going to, it, you know, it's like taking a car. The pork is a food that requires a lot of energy for digestion. Then if you're mixing it with potatoes, the starches are going to be utilized first.
Right.
So what happens there what's going to happen there is you're going to expend so much of your energy to digest that food that your body might even be in a deficit if you just had those foods. So you're going to, that's why many people have pork roast with potatoes, and about a half hour later on a cold day, you'll see they'll have a bead of sweat across their forehead. The reason for that is like taking a car. If you take your car and you let the engine idle, then if you're eating the pork and the potatoes, it's like pushing down the accelerator. You're going to have to expend, just like with a car, you're going to burn more gasoline. If you do that to digest that food, your body's going to have to respond to what you did to it. So the body's going to have to expend more energy. So you might not get as much energy out of that type of meal than if you got, say, you had a plate of pasta or a couple of potatoes, because it's much they're polysaccharides. It's much easier to absorb that into your system without expending a lot of energy. So the amount of energy left over for whatever you want to do, kinetic energy or the thinking process, you're going to have more energy.
So you're telling me that in order to reduce my pain, to manage my back pain, musculoskeletal pain, eat a high carbohydrate diet.
Yes.
Because proteins are made up of amino acids, right? So that must be acidic
form. Of course, the flesh foods, too. The byproducts that come along, you have to have protein.
Right. But
what we should do is reduce the...
Well, the American diet has too much
protein. Common mistake that most people think that the more protein, you need protein for healing, for cell revitalization.
Right.
It's not correct.
We have enough protein
If you're getting 30 to 50 grams of protein a day, which is kind of hard not to get enough protein, you're getting enough protein even if you're a strength athlete. Like this man I told you about that played with the Lakers. Now, this guy trains hard. He reduced his protein, and he doubled his energy because he's eating more fruits. He's eating vegetables.
Carbohydrates.
Right. And vegetables, you know, which they're not that high. The fuel content of vegetables is not that high, but you're getting a lot of vitamins and minerals from it. Plus, they're water plump foods. Water serves as a transport medium, too. So the buildup of the waste gases, the acids from the exertion that he goes through, it helps keep the system clean. His recovery time, he was telling me today how his recovery time is up. Like, they work out three times a day. He trains with the weights. It's unbelievable, the routine.
Yes.
Naturally, he's an exceptional athlete. He's a
professional.
Super physical specimen also.
Right.
So there's so much to this.
How about cigarettes? Are they acid-forming or alkaline-forming?
Definitely, they're acid-forming.
They're acid-forming.
Yeah. They're acid-forming, but the nicotine has a... anesthetizes you. In other words, it does have a pain-killing effect. Good deal of time when people stop smoking, they become aware of pain and, you know, any kind of a stimulant, like coffee also. If they stop smoking, stop drinking coffee, if they have any kind of inflammatory disease, like minor pain in their shoulder, besides, it'll intensify when you first stop it. Because they were anesthetized and they didn't realize it works as a painkiller.
Well, the coffee or tea, the caffeine, is that acid-forming?
Yeah, definitely. And the tea also has tannic acid, which is, for anybody that has any kind of stomach problems or joint pain.
And fats are made up of fatty acids.
Correct.
So you want to reduce your protein intake, you want to reduce your fatty acid intake, or fat intake too, right?
Well, fat takes the most energy to digest too. See, whenever your body has to go into that accelerated response, you're going to feel more pain. You're dividing your energy.
So you want to eat as much carbohydrates and get everything else off the list, off the diet.
Well, if you got a lot of pain, the best thing to do is to eat, you know, fruits and vegetables and cooked vegetables and some of the alkaline grains and a little bit of chicken, a little bit of fish, or a little piece of meat. You know, low fat, to keep everything lean. A low fat, high density diet is good for just about everything because it makes your body more efficient. The body has, like we said before, the human body has remedial capabilities. The more efficient you make your body, the better you're going to deal with any situation. You're going to deal better with recovery from surgery. You're going to deal better from a subluxation, any kind of inflammation. You're going to deal, it's going to help you have a better mental attitude. Your mind is going to be sharper. What I tell people is there's nothing about eating an alkaline diet. And you're getting all the foods, you're getting all the nutrients. There's no way you can be harmed. The only thing you could do is try it. And most people are going to be surprised about what the results will be. I see it all the time.
Well, I'd like to thank you very much for coming by here tonight. This half hour, we pretty much covered what people should avoid. We're going to do another half hour next week on foods people should eat to alkalinize their system.
Okay.
Pretty much we covered the foods that they should not eat, which acidify their system. I know Staten Island out there is very interested in natural approaches to health. I'd like to thank you for coming by today. You'll come back again next
Absolutely.
Week, right?
Absolutely, my pleasure.
Next week we'll talk about some recipes or some foods we can eat, enjoy, and foods that'll make us feel better.
Okay, thank you very much. I'll be very happy to come back, and I enjoyed myself. Thank you very much, Dr. Dolan.
Well, this is Dr. Victor Dolan for Good Health Naturally, signing off for this week in our series of How to Live with Your Back, talking about how to nutritionally manage your back pain or any other musculoskeletal pain as well. And for this week, I hope to see you next week. This is Dr. Victor Dolan bidding you goodbye and wishing you good health, naturally.